Hey, welcome to worship. It's so good to be together with you today. I know we're not really together, but we're still together. I'm here at my home and you're probably at your home. Welcome. My name's Dave Learned. I'm one of the campus pastors from our Rolling Meadows campus, and I'm really glad that we can do this together. Thank you, Lord, for technology that allows us, wherever we are, to come together to sing God's praises, to hear His word, and I'm really glad we're together today. Do you know, the last couple of weeks, we've had people checking in literally from all over the country. We've heard from Texas and Florida, and we've heard from California and New Mexico. That blows me away. I can't believe the reach that is possible. It's not just our country either. We've had people around the world, South Africa, the Netherlands, Germany. Hey, maybe that's you. Welcome back. We're glad that you're here today. Wherever you're from today, wherever you're joining us, I'd like to invite you to check in and let us know you're here. So that's available right on the screen there. Just let us know you're here. The other thing is, we're a church and we believe firmly in the power of prayer. So we'd love to pray for you today. Two ways to do that. In the chat function, you can type prayer, and we have staff online right now. They'd love to connect with you and pray for you personally. Or hit the prayer button above, submit a request, and our staff will pray for you this week. In any case, I'm very thankful for the opportunity to worship the Lord together today. Can I tell you a quick story? A couple of weeks ago for Easter, I got a follow-up opportunity with someone who clicked follow or texted follow to us at the end of the message saying they want to follow Christ. When I talked to them that next week, they said, you know, I live in the area. I used to go to church. I haven't gone to church since I was a kid, but my friend who's from the church invited me. I felt right at home. I was compelled by the message, and I do want to follow Jesus Christ. Now just think with me for a second. We're about to experience worship and hear from the Word. Who do you know who needs to get a text right now with the link to say, join me for church? You never know how the Lord might use that. So in any case, we're going to turn our full attention to Him now. He's worthy of our praise. Let's stand together wherever you are, and let's sing.
It's good to be here to worship the Lord. I want us to sing a song that we've been singing a number of years at our church. It sings the story of the gospel, but also it says, here I am to worship. That's a lyric that we've been singing as we've been gathered together in one building at our campuses, but now we are spread out across our homes. But it's still true. And I want to give you permission to just invite the Spirit into the room that you're worshiping in and saying, here I am to worship. Because when we turn our affections to God, He becomes present. Let's sing out the truth of the gospel together as we worship Him. Come on.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. That made this heart adore you, hope of a life spent with you.
So come on, let's sing it out.
Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God, 'cause you're all together.
Days.
King of all how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. No, I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross.
Come on, sing that.
We worship you.
Father, we worship you in this place for such a time as this. And you've received that praise here in spirit and truth and through the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen.
Yes, yes, it's so good for us to be able to worship the Lord together today. I want to just take a couple of moments and update you on opportunities to connect and some things that are happening that I think could be a help to you. The first one is this. We've had people every week that we've been online contacting us and saying, I want to follow Jesus Christ, or I have questions, or I want to learn more. We started a Wednesday night opportunity online called Exploring Christ, and we've had two of them, and we'd absolutely love to have you join us this week for number three. So come this Wednesday night, get the information, and join us for Exploring Christ. Another thing that's just a question I think a lot of people are asking is, what am I supposed to do? How am I supposed to respond to this COVID-19 crisis? And so our staff has actually created a website for you to go on. You can go there right now. It's how to respond to COVID-19 as a believer. There's opportunities there for worship. There's articles to read. There's things that you can engage with that will help you put your mind on the Lord and think about what He would have you to do during this time. So go check that out on the website. Also want you to know that we, while we can't be with our church family, we still love our church family, and we're looking for ways to care and connect. We talked last week about wanting to start a small business registry of people in our church, and that's been started. And I'm really thankful to tell you we've heard from more than 70 different businesses, small businesses run by people in our church. So we've put that into a directory that might be a great help to you. If you go to the website, harvestbiblechapel.org/business, you can choose there from different people that are in our community and in our church who could potentially help you as a small business. So let's, where we can, let's support them. Let's help them. I hope that'll be a blessing to you and them. Hey, one more thing. Harvest Students is in full swing, so I want you to check out this video.
Peace that God offers rule our thoughts, and that looks like letting that word filter and sift through what we have in our minds.
I think it's very clear that God's word is communicating to us right now that we can choose joy at all times.
Love it. Harvest Students, what a great ministry, and I love that it's online right now. Hey, Hannah, two of Harvest Students right here in my house, so I wanted to ask them. Hannah, what have you enjoyed about connecting online?
One thing that I've really enjoyed is still being able to meet with my small group, and I found that that's super encouraging to be able to connect, especially during this season.
Yeah, that's really, really good. Hey, Annika, how about you? What have you enjoyed about Harvest Students Online?
I enjoy that you can interact with people from all campuses, and it's tons of fun.
Can't beat that. That's fantastic. All right, well, we're at the point in the service where normally I would pray, or one of our pastors or leaders would pray, but we really want to give you the opportunity to pray. And specifically, I want to ask that you would pray for our students right now. Here's three thoughts. You could pray for peace internally as they walk through this time. You could pray for their patience while they're walking through uncertain times, just like all of us are. And then let's pray for this, that they would have an impact for Jesus Christ as they're interacting with their friends at this time. So you're going to pray now, and in a moment, I will close us in prayer. Let's pray. Yes, Lord, hear our prayers on behalf of these students. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we're going to continue in worship now, and as our pastors were talking this week, we really just wanted the opportunity to share some scriptures with you that are a reminder to us of who the Lord is, our refuge, and so I'm going to start. Psalm 62, verse 8 says, "Trust in Him at all times, O people. Pour out your heart before Him. God is a refuge for us."
Psalm 46, 1 and 2, "God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore we will not fear, though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea."
Proverbs 18:10. "The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous man runs into it and is safe."
Psalm 37:39 and 40. "The salvation of the righteous is from the Lord. He is their stronghold in the time of trouble. The Lord helps them and delivers them. He delivers them from the wicked and saves them, because they take refuge in Him."
Psalm 119, verse 114 says this, "You are my hiding place and my shield. I hope in your word."
Psalm 18, verses 1 and 2. "I love you, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer. My God, my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold, my Masada," is the Hebrew.
Psalm 34, 8, "Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in Him."
Psalm 9, verse 9, "The Lord is a stronghold for the oppressed, a stronghold in the times of trouble."
From Psalm 91, "He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust."
"You will not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrows that fly by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in darkness, nor the destruction that wastes at noonday.
1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you.
Because you have made the Lord your dwelling place, the Most High, who is my refuge."
To you I run. Hey, Harvest. It's interesting how important it is to have the correct perspective on something, isn't it? When you have the wrong perspective on something, it just feels off. It feels not right. It's hard to explain. You just feel wrong. Sure, you could try to make it work, but always in the back of your mind, you're thinking, is this right? Is this the way I should be viewing this? Something feels misaligned in my head and in my heart and in my soul. It's unnatural. It feels uncomfortable. It feels out of place. Sometimes it feels downright annoying. So let's fix it. Wow, that's better, isn't it? Things are more stable. This feels better. We're seeing this more clearly. Having the right perspective is important. And we're going to be taking a look at a topic today that we need to make sure that we have the right perspective on. That brings us to the title of the message today. The title is Marriage Plus Divorce, Having the Right Perspective. We're going to be in the book of Mark, chapter 10, verse 1 through 12. You're probably thinking, Pastor Tommy, you always get the easiest topics to cover when you preach. I know. It's a blessing. It's a blessing. That may have sounded sarcastic. And it was. But I want you to know that I'm truly feeling blessed to bring this topic to our church family today. See, this is a hard topic. This is a very personal and sometimes visceral topic for some in our church. And whether you know someone who has gone through or is going through divorce, or maybe your parents have gone through a divorce, or maybe you've been through this yourself, I just want you to know this before we start. There is grace. We are a church that is filled with grace. Some churches condemn and cast out those who have been through divorce. Our church is not one of those. God loves you. Therefore, we love you. We are a gracious people because the ground is level before the cross. Yet, you need to know that real love rejoices in the truth. That's why I want you to understand we are also a church that pursues truth. And the source of truth is the Bible, the inerrant word of God, where we believe every word is inspired by God, which is why we can rest that the scriptures do in fact have everything we need to know pertaining to life and godliness. And we do not shy away from teaching the authority of God's word on this or any topic. Also, before we jump into the passage, I want to address another group of people. We're going to be talking about marriage and divorce today. And I know that many single people are going to be listening to this sermon. Can I just encourage you? Lean in today. You may not be in the season of life where you are living this out, but you will hear truths from God's word for your ministry toolbox to help others. And also, if you're called to marriage, you'll be more prepared when you get there. Let's pray. God, we come before you right now as we open your word. We pray, Lord, for wisdom. God, I pray right now that you move me out of the equation and you speak clearly through your word. You have a word for us today. Lord, would we lean in to the truth of your word today? Would it impact our hearts and transform our lives? We love you, Lord. Be with us as we go through your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let's look at the scripture together. Mark 10, verse 1 through 6. Here's the first thing that we're going to see. Remember, we need to have the right perspective about marriage and divorce. We're going to go through three things that we need to have that right perspective. Here's the first thing. It's a reference point. Look at verse 1 with me. And he left there and went to the region of Judea and beyond the Jordan, and crowds gathered to him again. And again, as was his custom, he taught them. And Pharisees came up in order to test him. They asked, if it was lawful for a man to divorce his wife. He answered them, what did Moses command you? They said, Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of divorce and send her away. And Jesus said to them, because of your hardness of heart, he wrote you this command. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. There's a break here right in the text, right in the beginning, a significant change of location for Jesus. He's not teaching in his Galilean homeland anymore. He's now teaching beyond the Jordan in an area known as Perea. It shows this important truth, that Jesus' popularity does not decrease, even though he is far from home. Crowds still gather to hear the teaching of Jesus. Note this, it says, and again, as was his custom, he taught them. This is just Jesus, the radical teacher. And we are about to see again just how radical of a teacher he is. Starting at verse 2, it says, and the Pharisees came up in order to test him and asked, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife? Newsflash. They don't actually want to learn from Jesus here. Look at what the text says. It says, in order to test him. They weren't looking for an answer. They were trying to trap Jesus. You see, there were two views surrounding this topic in the time of Jesus. One from a rabbi named Shammai, who allowed divorce only in the case of adultery, and the much more popular position by the rabbi Hillel, which allowed divorce for almost any reason. She burned a meal, divorce. She showed her ankles, divorce. She got a bad haircut, divorce. Basically, anything that you could somehow fit into this box of indecency was allowance for divorce. Not too dissimilar from our society today, right? You can legally divorce for any reason you want. So this was the trap being laid for Jesus. You have to pick who you agree with or disagree with both, which certainly would upset one or both of these groups. There's also the possibility that they were trying to make what happened to John the Baptist happen to Jesus. Remember, John the Baptist was arrested and executed by Herod for criticizing his divorce and then remarriage. They were trying to trap him. They were saying, look, Jesus, come on, look at this question. Look at it. Look at this sun butter. It has less carbs. It's organic. It's healthier for you. Go on. Just take a bite. Just take a bite of that. But come on, Jesus doesn't fall for that. He doesn't take the bait. He is the radical teacher. He cuts straight through the social norms, the established tradition, the culture, and the customs of the day, and he goes straight to the Word of God. He first brings them back to Moses, because that's the place where they are forming their view of divorce from. And they answer him, and he brings light to that scripture that they're misusing. He tells them that the reason that that was allowed was because of their hardness of heart. In other words, because of their disobedience and rebellion toward God. This was allowed because of human failure and sin, and it was preventing even greater harm from coming. But this was never God's intention for marriage. And so Jesus brings them back to the scripture again, to God's true intention and purpose and heart for marriage in scripture. Jesus could have given his opinion here, could have given his take on the issue, and that would have also been considered scripture because he's God. But he doesn't. He is teaching us an important truth through his actions. The reference point for everything in our life should be in scripture. How do you answer the difficult topics of life? You go straight to scripture. We need to follow Jesus' example here. We need to go straight to scripture as our reference point. But often we don't. We don't go to scripture as our reference point. We visit other places for our reference point. Places like our feelings. How do I feel about this? Well, I'm not feeling super good about what that says. I don't feel like doing that. It just doesn't feel right in my heart, in my soul. That doesn't feel good. Sometimes we take the reference point of our feelings. Sometimes we take the reference point of society. Well, what's the world think? What does everyone else think? What does society say? What's the majority say? What are they saying out there? I want to be in line with that. I don't want to be some outsider. I don't want to be someone who's not conforming to what society says. I want to be a part of that. I want to make sure that that's where my reference point is. I don't want to be outcast. Maybe another reference point is tradition. What do you mean? This is the way we've always done it. We've always done it this way. This is our tradition. Why would we change this? Why would we do something different? Why would we change our reference point? Listen, our reference point in all things, especially difficult topics like the one we're going through today, should be God's word. It should cut through my feelings and society and anything else that seeks to be the reference point in our lives. So we need the right reference point, the Bible. And now we are going to look at the next piece, a viewpoint. Viewpoint. Look at verse 6 through 9 with me. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let not man separate. There it is. God's perfect purpose and plan for marriage. Jesus shows them the viewpoint of God on the issue of marriage and divorce. What is God's heart for marriage? It's right here. And it's been there since the beginning of creation. There's so many truths, wonderful truths from this passage that show us the viewpoint of God on marriage. That marriage is between one man and one woman. It's heterosexual, man and woman. It's also one man and one woman. It's monogamous. The other truth that we know is that marriage is a man and a woman becoming one flesh, being two individuals and becoming one flesh. Marriage is the creation of a new family. We see that here in the text as well, leaving the father and mother and clinging to the spouse. It's creation of a new family unit. Marriage is a covenant between God, a man, and a woman, God bringing it, joining it together. And marriage is for a lifetime. Whatever God has joined together, let not man separate. Those are right here in the passage. And here are some additional truths from Scripture about marriage. Marriage is the picture of Jesus and the church and God and his people. We see that throughout the Bible. Marriage also reflects the image of God. We see that in Genesis 1. Marriage is designed to glorify God. Marriage was created by God. There are many more truths about marriage in God's word, but I hope you can understand. Marriage is a pretty big deal to God. As you can see, he takes it very seriously. This is the intention God had for marriage. So anything outside of this intention is not God's will or his purpose for marriage. That's why Jesus is answering the question this way. Instead of giving an answer of yes or no to the Pharisees to their question, being the radical teacher that he is, he brings them straight to the source, straight to the only viewpoint that matters on this subject, the viewpoint of the one who created and purposed it for us, God. This is the single most important human relationship that you can have. It's so important that God calls it two becoming one flesh. Well, what does that mean? It means that there are no longer two individual people. There is one married couple, becoming one physically, becoming one emotionally, becoming one intellectually, becoming one in every single other way, and most of all, becoming one spiritually. This is all being joined together in oneness by God, that man may not separate. It looks a little bit like this. We've got man and we've got woman. Blue for men, red for women. These are two individual glasses right now, a man and a woman. But when the act of marriage, the covenant of marriage, the sacredness of marriage takes place, something happens. The two become one. And no longer are they two individuals. They are now one. What once was blue man and red woman, now you have just one. Blended together. Oneness together. I hope that helps illustrate what oneness is. Because this oneness is for our good. and it's for God's glory. And so we need to hold fast to the viewpoint of God on marriage, that it is sacred. Why? Because we live in a world that is not unlike the one Jesus is teaching to in this passage. Divorce was rampant in the day of Jesus. They did not regard marriage from the viewpoint of God. It was not sacred. It was a means to an end to satisfy their selfish desires. Same with our world. Divorce is rampant. Marriage is not viewed as sacred. It is viewed as a means to an end to satisfy our selfish desires. You want to know what the leading cause of divorce is? It's sin. Sorry, I didn't mean to Jesus juke you there, but it's true. Sin is the cause of any divorce. Whether it's more prevalent in one spouse or the other or both, sin is the problem. Selfishness, lust, unlovingness, pride, anger, on and on and on. But let me give you the actual data. The number one cause for divorce is this: basic incompatibility. What does that mean? It means falling out of love or intimacy, and it's followed closely by lack of communication. This is what I'm talking about. This is a cheapening of marriage. These are the reasons you break up with your high school crush, not end a marriage. Marriage has been cheapened. It is not seen from the viewpoint of God or with oneness in mind. Those leading causes of divorce can be worked through with selfless sacrifice to one another, treating each other more significantly than themselves, loving one another as Christ loved the church, sacrificially and unconditionally. We cannot cheapen marriage. We must look at it from the viewpoint of God. It is a sacred covenant. And so in light of God's viewpoint on marriage here in the text, what would you say that God's view of divorce is? It's probably not for it, right? Well, let's get into the last point. We have our reference point. It's the Bible. We have our viewpoint, that of God. Let's look at this last one, a breaking point. Look at verse 10. And in the house, the disciples asked him again about this matter. So Jesus does this more and more now throughout the book of Mark. He starts teaching his disciples privately. He is preparing them for the time when he won't be with them physically any longer. So he's teaching them in the house, and then he says this to them. Look at verse 11. And he said to them, "Whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery." This must have come across as a shocking statement to the disciples, because you see, divorce always constituted remarriage in their day. And so it probably came across as a shocking statement, and it probably comes across as a shocking statement to you as well. Remember, as we've been saying through the book of Mark, Jesus addresses the issues of the heart. He's not just about the surface level. He goes deeper, and he's doing that here. Jesus' argument with the Pharisees earlier is that divorce is in opposition to God's purpose and plan. He's further stating now, the one that divorces and remarries commits adultery. God's design for marriage is at the heart level, and the action of remarriage is a mockery of God's original design. It's one man, one woman for a lifetime. Not one man and one woman now and another later. That's not his design. Now, this has to be said right here. Here at Harvest, we believe that there is biblical allowance provided in Scripture for divorce and remarriage without it being considered adultery. It's most popularly argued from Matthew 5:32, Matthew 19:9, and 1 Corinthians 7:15. We don't have time in this sermon to mine the depths of those passages, but I will say this. They are there, and if it's applicable to you, number one, it should never be your first action, ever. Number two, you should never make that decision alone. Reach out to your local pastor or elders immediately and start the conversation with them. And number three, if you or your children are in obvious danger, you need to leave immediately. Separate now, call the authorities, and call your pastor for care. Okay, back to the text. Jesus is reinforcing the seriousness of God's heart in regards to marriage. This is important. This has to be valued. This is to be upheld. Why? Because it isn't, and divorce takes place. And when divorce takes place, lives are destroyed. God is again trying to protect us from ourselves. If you've been through divorce or had it happen in your family or even to someone close to you, you know the devastation that it brings. Children torn from their mothers or fathers, hearts scarred so badly it takes decades for it to be healed. Family members alienated, friends lost forever, trust destroyed. Divorce reaps devastation. Why is it that way? Remember, it's because it's a mockery of God's design for oneness in marriage. Remember this. The two shall become one. And when you become one, this is no longer possible. You're not allowed, you can't separate that. You can't pour it back and for that to be blue anymore, or pour it back and for this to be red anymore. The two have become one. And you can't separate this. What God has brought together, let not man separate. The only thing that you can do is you can try to destroy it. You can try to destroy it. I'm not going to destroy this because then my wife would destroy me. But listen, when you try to destroy God's purpose and plan, that ripple of destruction goes forth like a shockwave from your life. So what does God think of divorce? God hates divorce. Divorce breaks God's heart. But listen to me. He does not hate divorcees. He does not hate you. He loves you. And if you've done it wrong in the past, there's forgiveness for you in Jesus Christ. You need to know that. Go to him. He will not turn you away. So we know God's heart for marriage, and thus we know his heart toward divorce. So where does that leave us? It leaves us at the point of reflection. Reflection on our own marriages. The reality is, and this might be shocking to newlyweds, there's no such thing as a perfect marriage. I don't have one. You don't have one. No one has one. Sin is going to enter the marriage and it's going to start to wreak havoc. And if left unchecked, you're going to at some point reach the breaking point in your marriage. Sometimes it's the first year, sometimes it's the fifth, sometimes it's the 10th or even later. And sometimes you'll hit it multiple times. And what you do and continue to do once you've hit that breaking point will determine the trajectory of your marriage. So if you're there now, I know me and my wife have been there, or you can see it going in that direction, or you want to keep yourself from that breaking point altogether, start here. Start right here. Don't do three things and make sure you do one thing. Don't do three things and make sure you do one thing. Here's the three don'ts. The first one, don't follow your heart. This is the worst advice that anyone could ever give someone. The Bible tells us that our heart is deceitfully wicked above all things and only bent on destruction. I don't know about you, but that doesn't sound like something that I want to follow. We shouldn't follow our heart. You know, me and my son, Zion, we watch Disney quite a bit nowadays. And that is a very popular phrase that they use in Disney, follow your heart. And every time that phrase comes up and we're watching a movie together, I will pause the Disney movie and I will look over at my son and I will tell him, son, that is terrible advice. Do not follow your heart. It's bad advice. Don't do it. Don't follow your heart. Here's the second thing. Don't make a decision in isolation. Don't make a decision in isolation. There is wisdom in many counselors. Let your small group come alongside you. If you're coming to the breaking point and this is a point of decision, get input from your small group. Go and get counseling from your local elder, your local pastor. Don't make this decision in isolation. And here's the third don't, and hear me out on this. Don't sign the divorce papers. Don't do it. Don't sign them. Don't call the lawyer. Don't prepare them. Don't get them ready. Not yet. Not before you do this one thing. Fight for your marriage. Fight for your marriage. God's heart for your marriage is restoration and reconciliation and redemption. This is God's heart. It always has been and it always will be. The Bible is clear about this. God is for reconciliation and restoration and redemption. Let me share a story with you. It's the story of Hosea and Gomer. Maybe you've heard the story before. Hosea was a prophet in the Old Testament. And God called Hosea to marry Gomer, who was a prostitute. And Hosea obeyed, and he went and he married Gomer, and they had children together. But then one day, Gomer left. Gomer abandoned Hosea and their children, and she went off back to the life of sexual immorality and adultery now against Hosea. That's pretty intense. Hosea was pretty upset about it, rightfully so. He had some pretty good reasons to sign those divorce papers and send Gomer away. Is that what God told him to do? Did God tell Hosea, listen, that's a pretty bad rap, man. That's hard. I know you're feeling bad, but here, you're free now. You can go and divorce her and send her away. It's not what God says. God tells Hosea to go after her, to pursue her, to buy her back, to treat her as pure, to fight for their marriage, to bring reconciliation and restoration and redemption to the marriage. God's heart is for restoration, and this is a worthy thing to fight for. Do not give up and throw in the towel. Stand firm in the word of God and fight for your marriage. Fight for it. Now you might be thinking, how do I do that? We've been bad for so long. So many things have taken place, you don't even understand. How can I even begin to start to fight for my marriage? Listen, this is not an exhaustive list at all, but it is a starting place. Start here. Number one, choose to serve. Choose to serve. Kill the selfishness inside of you and serve your spouse. Consider them more significant than yourself. Kill the me time and spend it serving your spouse. I'm telling you, that's a way to fight for your marriage. Number two is maybe you've done some bad things. Maybe you've messed up. Maybe your spouse has messed up. Here's a second way you can fight for your marriage. Confess humbly. Confess humbly. And if you're the one who is receiving the confession, the apology, receive it in grace. Receive it in grace towards them. Fight for your marriage. Number three, be intentional. Be intentional, be thoughtful. This is the perfect time to do this. We are in quarantine for who knows how much longer. This is the perfect time to be intentional about your marriage. Thoughtful, breakfast in bed, serving one another, doing thoughtful things, writing them notes, making them feel special. Fight for your marriage, be intentional. Here's the fourth thing, give it your highest priority. Maybe you've been in a season like many of us have been in where your priorities have shifted, and maybe it's been a really long time, but your highest priority right now is not your marriage. Maybe it's your job. Maybe it's your hobby. I mean, maybe it's even your kids right now. Fight for your marriage. Bring those things down on the priority pole and send your marriage straight to the top of the priority list. Give it your highest priority. And here's number five, fight for your marriage. Get on your knees and pray. Pray for restoration. Pray for reconciliation. Pray for redemption. Pray for your spouse. Pray for your own heart. Pray for your marriage to be renewed. Pray. Get on your knees and pray. God's going to answer that prayer. It's His heart. It's His desire. He desires reconciliation and restoration and redemption and marriage. Get on your knees and pray like you've never prayed before. Fight for your marriage. You know what I've never seen or heard as top reasons for divorce on any statistic or any research? Any of the things that I just listed. No one is getting divorced because they were served too well or apologized to, or someone was being too intentional and thoughtful, or making them their number one priority, or praying too much for their marriage. Don't get divorced for that. I've never heard that before. Fight for your marriage. It is worth it. A perfect marriage isn't possible, but you can certainly have a good marriage. You can have a good one with joy centered in Christ. And with your reference point as the Bible, and with the viewpoint that God has of marriage, you can fight through your breaking point and have a healthy marriage. Let me leave us with this practical step that we can all do this week. I want you to sit down sometime this week to ask your spouse this question. Ask them this question. What is it like to live on the other side of me? What is it like to live on the other side of me? Don't interrupt. Don't justify. Don't explain away. Don't make painful faces. Just sit quietly and listen to their answer. And once you have their answer, then start fighting for your marriage in those areas first. Let's pray. God, we come before you right now, humbled by your word, challenged by your word. Lord, we pray right now that, one, when we're looking at topics that are difficult like this, that our reference point would constantly be the scripture. Lord, bring us back to your word time and time again about what it says. And Lord, when we're thinking about marriage, our own marriages, Lord, would we see it as sacred as you see it as sacred? It's a big deal. You hold it in high regard, and so do we, Lord. So help us. Help us as we view our own marriages that way. Lord, I pray for any marriage that is at the breaking point, approaching the breaking point. Lord, I pray right now that you would give them the strength and urgency to fight for their marriage, that they would seek reconciliation and restoration and redemption. Lord, would you be with them as they walk through that together? It's not going to be easy. There's going to be a lot of hard days. But Lord, you are faithful and you walk alongside us every step of the way. Lord, I pray for those who have been through the tragedy of divorce. Lord, in the pain and destruction that that brings, Lord, would you continue to heal them? Continue to heal their hearts. Lord, would they know that they are so loved by you and that you have grace upon grace upon grace for them, just as you have grace upon grace for all of us. And so, Lord, we praise you. We thank you for our time in the Word today. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. Stop working, way you make it. light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are a way maker, a miracle worker, a promise keeper. Light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
Thank you.
What a good word from the Lord, and that marriage is worth it, and it's worth fighting for. Why? Because that's how God has designed it to be. And so wherever your situation, maybe you're single, maybe you're married, maybe you've walked through some of these things, our help is in the Lord. He is the way maker, and it is always worth it to obey Him and to do what He's calling us to. Well, we're really glad for this opportunity that we had to worship together. We're here to be of help. We'd love to hear from you. You can still submit a prayer request. You can join us online for any of the events that we've mentioned during this service. And just to remind you, we now have this small business list of small businesses from our church. So go check that out, harvestbiblechapel.org/business. And we're here to be of help any way we can. Thanks for joining us for worship today. You are loved.